welcome everybody to Crossroads this morning. We invite you to stand with us and sing with us.
Today, today, excited to worship you this morning. Amen. Hey, take a few seconds to say hi to the folks around you and continue to stand as we worship this morning.
bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again.
Go ahead and take a seat.
Good morning, everyone. Hey, I want to welcome you to Crossroads today. My name is Rod. I'm one of the pastors here. And what you just saw was a preview for our upcoming series that starts next week called Game Changers that will take us through the entire month of November. And in your program today, we have a flyer that gives you more details on how this series is laid out. And we want to encourage you to be a part of all 3 weekends and bring people with you. And if this is your first time here at Crossroads or you're new, we want to extend a special welcome to you. We said that you have picked a great weekend to be here. In a few moments, you're going to hear our senior pastor, John Smith, interview Olympic medalist, Janay Loach. And I've sat through the last, yeah, you guys can clap for that. It's great. And I got to tell you, I sat through both interviews Saturday night and at the 9 o'clock service. It is just fantastic. And you're in for a real treat in just a few moments. But it also gives me opportunity to say, you know, you are welcome here on any given weekend when you're new here, because we've designed this place to be a kind of place that you can come and find out more about who God is and his plan for your life. And you are welcome here on any weekend. And we hope that you have a great experience today and that you'd come back and join us for this series, Game Changers. And a way to kind of get to know us better as a church is by taking some time to read through that program that you received. In fact, let's all bring that out. And in it, I'd like to highlight a couple things that are taking place throughout the life of our church. One of them being is maybe for some of us, we've asked this question. You know, I wonder what it means to be a part of this church family and what it means to commit to saying, you know, I'm in. I'm part of what Crossroads is doing. Or maybe you just simply like to find out, how did this church start? What are our values? What's the DNA of this church? Well, we have just a class for you. It's our participating membership class that takes place next Sunday, November 11th. It's from 12:30 to 3 p.m. Again, it's led by our senior pastor, John Smith. You get to meet the entire staff, but it's 2 hours. It's just an incredible experience. And we do provide lunch and childcare up to the third grade. So if you're planning to join us, we have a great team that prepares this class for us. And it's very helpful to us to let us know who's coming so we can get enough lunch and childcare. So if you don't mind registering online, or better yet, just take a few moments after service, stop by the information table, and you can sign up for their immediate after service. And there are some people to help you do that. The second thing I'd like to talk about is something that we've been doing here at Crossroads for 14 years. And in the 1950s, a group of pastors got together in this lovely community, and they said, how can we best serve our community in some very practical ways? And the end result of that discussion was something called the House of Neighborly Services. And since then, they've provided incredible services to our community, counseling services, life planning, and so forth. In addition to that, they help stock a food bank to help people in need. And for 14 years, like I mentioned, we've participated in something called Stuff the Truck. And what Stuff the Truck is we simply bring up a big truck, and what we simply do is we stuff it with food items. And when you walk out today, you're going to be given a grocery bag just like this. And on it gives some specific instructions on some of the food items they most need. And what we simply do with that is bring back the bags full of food next weekend at either one of our services, whether it's Sunday morning at 9:11 or Saturday at 4:30 p.m. We bring this back. And this is one of the ways that Crossroads can help the community that we're living in. Well, at this time, we're going to continue our time of worship together as we worship through our giving. And for those of us who are following the teachings of Christ and consider Crossroads our church home, this is a regular part of our spiritual practices, whether we give here in the service, out at the giving kiosk in the atrium, or if we give online, we consider it a privilege to invest in what God is doing here. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your goodness and your love, and we thank you that you exemplified a generous spirit. And God, when I think about how you are using this church to help people understand that they're loved by you, that they can be forgiven, that they can be experienced grace, when I think about how people, through you using this church, have all of a sudden experienced fullness and purpose in life, how they see marriages restored, how they see addictions overcome, I gladly give back to what you're doing here. And so God, we trust that you're gonna use what you received today to further and continue the work that you're doing through Crossroads Church. And we ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. Though this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
Since fifth time down the runway, good speed, hits the board nicely, lets her head fall forward though just as she was about to land, but out towards that bronze medal line. She's just not happy with the effort because she remembers that big foul that was well over 23 feet. She leaves about 3 inches on the board, but she did run right through it. But look at, she puts her head down early. That makes your legs go down early. Waiting for the measurement. 22.7 1/4. That puts her in third place by 1 centimeter. Still has one left. Anita Redovica now in the sixth round, currently in fourth by 1 centimeter behind the American. Can she knock her off the podium? Redovica has a personal best of 22.8 1/2, so she's certainly capable. She gets a good place on the board, but right there on that bronze medal line, and she knows it's close, it's fair. She had a little bit of a tailwind, but 22.3 1/2, it's not gonna do it, and that guarantees Janay Deloach the bronze medal. So as unhappy as she was with her effort, it was enough to put her on the podium. And the first time, two medals for the U.S. in the long jump. Reese with the gold, Deloach with the bronze.
Yeah, pretty good. Well, in the Summer Olympics of 2012 in London, England, Janay Deloach won a bronze medal, capturing the world's attention. And we're thrilled that Janay is part of Crossroads Church, along with her husband, Patrick, and very excited that she's willing to share part of her journey with us in all of our services this weekend. So why don't you help me give a warm Crossroads welcome to Olympian Janay Deloach. Have a seat. I think we have the middle school group in here with us today. There they are. We're glad you guys are in here. Very glad. Well, when you won the bronze that night, that was historic for you, but it was also historic for women's track and field from the United States. Tell us about that.
That was first time in history that the women USA track and field team collected 7 medals in one evening.
7 medals in one evening. You were part of it. That's this one. I mean, that's the first Olympic medal I've ever seen in my life. How many other people? First one. Look at that. And I'm going to begin by asking the question everybody wants to know right now. How you jumped that far? I mean, really? How'd you jump that far? Did you ever run? You didn't have a running start, did you?
I did.
You did? Oh, well, you had a running start. But you know how far that is? That is 6.89 meters, 22 feet, 7 1/4 inches. That's like from the edge of the stage here, out to almost to the cameras there, about 3 rows in front. Outstanding, isn't it? Very good. Why don't you have a seat? Let's talk about this. Let's talk about this journey that you've been on, because you didn't start out as a long jumper in athletics. Tell us a little bit about your life, where you're from and where you went to school.
Well, I'm a military brat, so my dad was in the Air Force, and we kind of moved all over the place, and we ended up in Alaska, and sports in Alaska, especially for track and field, it's a pretty short season because of the weather, so naturally I was a basketball player. And so I played basketball all 4 years and did track on the side. I did it because it was fun to go, you know, do a couple of long jumps and then go play a basketball game.
Sure.
And that's how I ended up at CSU. I got a scholarship to CSU.
Was that for basketball?
It wasn't for basketball. Okay. I wanted to do basketball, but I was getting more money for track and field, and so thinking about my family and the finances associated with that, I decided to take a track scholarship.
So track and field in Alaska, and people from Alaska listen to these podcasts and watch our services, and we love Alaska, but it can't be that long of an outdoor track season.
So you're playing
basketball, but in a shortened season, you're good enough to get a scholarship to a Division I school, CSU. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And was that in long jump?
That was in long jump, yeah.
In long jump. Mm-hmm. So you went to CSU, you developed those abilities, and then what made you ever think of, you know, I want to be an Olympian?
You know, at first I didn't really like track and field, to be honest. I mean, I did it because it was fun, but I didn't want to work at it. It was too much running.
Too much work, too much running.
Too much running, you know. Yes. I was thinking, who wants to run that much? Not me. So, you know, it turned out that I was pretty good at it, and so I developed a love for it, and then, you know, years later, here I am.
And you were a professional track and field person, mm-hmm. you know, and I saw a picture that's in the atrium, and you'll be able to see it on the TV screen that's out there. A number of medals, that's before you won this bronze. What were some of those medals for?
Some of them were, you know, one of them was from Indoor USA Championships. They hold in Albuquerque. I won that one. That was the year I first made it.
Wow.
I went out and won.
You won.
I won. Another one was from outdoors last year at the USA Championships, where I made it to the World Championship. And another one was from this year, Indoor World Championships, where I got a silver medal.
Indoor World Championships. So tell us a little bit about how you get to the Olympic Games. What's involved in, you know, how do you get picked? How do you get selected to be part of that?
Well, in order to make it to the Olympics Games, you have to place top three in your event at the Olympic Trials. And to get to the Olympic Trials isn't easy either, because you have to have a standard to get there. So I had to jump so far in order to make it to the Olympic Trials. Okay. And then not only that, you have to place top three, which is very difficult to do. And then you can go on, but you have to get to those things first.
So you had to be in the top three at the trials to make the Olympic team. And to be in the top three, where are you ranking in the world to be in the top three on the U.S. Olympic team?
You have to be top three.
Yeah, you got to be at the top.
You have to be at the top of your game. To make the Olympic team for the United States, you basically had to be the mm-hmm. best in the world. And I was trailing, just behind the number one person in the world, which was Brittany Reese, who won the mm-hmm. Olympics. And I was glad to just be close to her mm-hmm. at the time.
What kind of pressure did you feel at the trials?
An enormous amount of pressure. Uh-huh. Because I had a goal. My goal was to go to the Olympics and win a gold medal. But the only obstacle standing in the way was making it on the team. And I couldn't achieve that goal if I didn't make it past mm-hmm. that obstacle. Mm-hmm. And I felt very anxious about sure. the situation. And there's so many girls that were up and coming, just graduated, that are jumping really well. And I saw them and I was like, okay, this is going to be difficult. It was hard to sleep. I couldn't eat much, just my anxiety level was really high. Yeah. And it was a very stressful weekend.
Yeah. And this is the trials. We're not talking about the Olympic Games. We're just talking about getting on the team and making it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was going through your head when you were, that was in Eugene, Oregon. What was going through your head when you were qualifying?
Please, God, let me make this.
Sure. Let me make it. What are some of the challenges that you face, physically, emotionally?
Emotionally, because it was such a big event and I was so anxious about it, mm-hmm. I had a hard time sleeping. I had sure. a hard time getting any nutrients in me because I just didn't have an appetite. I was so mm-hmm. nervous. And you wake up hoping you're going to feel good, but unfortunately on the day of my finals at the trials, I woke up not feeling that great at all.
The finals to make the team, you wake up, you're not feeling good.
Yeah.
What are you feeling?
Something I called lead legs.
Lead legs.
I, because I wasn't getting enough nutrients and sleeping well, your body reacts to mm-hmm. Not sleeping and eating correctly. And for me, that's, a buildup in the legs where they actually feel heavy. They feel swollen and heavy, and we call those lead legs.
Yeah.
And I woke up that morning, and I stood up, and the first thing I thought was, oh, no, I have lead legs.
Really? You knew it immediately. Mm-hmm. So what do you do? What did you do?
At that point, there's really nothing you can do. You don't feel that great, so it's, you put a prayer up and, mm-hmm. and do your best, because there's nothing more you can do. You can hope, but literally, you just don't feel that great.
But you did. You made the team.
I did.
You made it. You mm-hmm. got on the Olympic team, and you go to London then. What do you hope to accomplish as you go to London?
The ultimate goal, which was to win a gold medal.
Yeah.
So that was my accomplishment. That was my expectation, was to have a fantastic time, because I was uh-huh. going to win a gold medal.
Yeah, that's what you're focused on. Mm-hmm. That's mentally, that's what you're hoping to achieve and you're striving for. Yeah. So you get to the Olympic Games. Tell us a little bit about the ceremony. How many people watched the opening ceremony? Most of the people here. We were enthralled by it. Tell us a little bit what it was like to be part of that.
Well, I always remember the first thing is the outfits.
The outfits.
I felt a little silly wearing the outfit. I put it on and I was in my room and I put the hat on and I looked in the mirror and I thought...
I think we have it. Yeah, there it is.
And at first I was like, I look like a schoolgirl. I should have a backpack. And, and these long dresses and then the socks are up to here and it's just uh-huh. not my style. And the shoes hurt your feet. And but you go down and then you see everyone else. You don't feel as silly, but...
Uh-huh. You see the whole team. You see And as people come into the ceremony, are they with, you know, the basketball teams together, the swimmers are together, track and field? Is that the way it is?
Not at the opening ceremonies. That's where, you know, that's like the biggest difference of between any other day and the opening ceremonies is that you have that outfit on and you're walking. You might be next to a fellow track and field athlete or even a swimmer or even a basketball player. But at that time, you're not in those different teams. You are the United States of America. You represent the USA.
That must have impacted you a lot in that, you know, long jump is so much individual.
Yeah.
Then you come together and you go, wait a minute, I am part of a team, part of a community, even, if you will. You know, and so tell us a little bit about you go into that ceremony, you know, you walk into the stadium. What does it hit you, or have you been in so many competitions that you're kind of used to that?
Well, at the time, you know, when the teams are walking into the stadium, they literally leave from the Olympic Village and make their way down to the stadium. And it's a long time it takes because all of the teams around the world are going into the stadium and coming out, so you have to wait your turn. And, you know, there's teams that are just as big as ours and to smaller teams, but, I mean, it took forever. So by the time we got to, you know, the doors of the stadium, I wanted to turn back around because my feet were killing me in these shoes that we had.
And your feet are important for your event.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
And, you know, I almost was like, I don't want to do this. My feet are killing me. We should just, you know, turn around, go right now. But it wasn't until I walked into the stadium and I saw the lights and I saw people taking pictures. I saw other athletes, you know, with their eyes big as saucers. Yeah. And that was when I was like, I made it here. This is my time. This is, you know, we all did this together, but I'm here for me.
Yeah, wow, you know? That's outstanding.
And another big part of the opening ceremonies that I'll always remember is the lighting of the torch. I was very close to the lighting of the torch, just right here from to the front row. And I don't know if you guys saw it, but it was splayed out kind of really big, and then they lit it, and then it kind of came, drew together in this enormous torch. I was so close, I could feel the heat of the torch.
Wow.
And I thought to myself at that moment, and I looked around, and you know, everyone's chins are on the ground.
Yeah.
And that was when I was like, I'm really, really here. Not just in the stadium, but I'm really here. And that was a moment I will never, ever forget.
Right, you could even feel it.
You could feel the heat.
That you were there. And then your event doesn't start for, you know, I'm not sure if it was 10 days, but it, pretty close, 10, 11 days before your long jump event. Tell us a little bit about how you stay focused during that length of time.
Well, I was fortunate enough to have my family out in London with me. So my mom, my dad, my brother, and my husband, they were all out there with me. And it's easy for me to stay focused when I have family and that support system for me. So I had to use that time to get away from track and field, to not focus so much on my goal that it just took over my life. So I used that time to go out to see London with my family, to see Big Ben, the London Eye, the Thames River, all the historical things that you can possibly see in London. I was able to see with my family and enjoy that, and to take away from just focusing so hard and wanting so badly to win a gold medal.
Sure.
So I had to find a balance, and that was my time, you know, in those 9 to 10, 11 days, however many it was, to really just kind of get away from that and balance myself.
So much of this is physical. I mean, the physical aspect of your sport and the training that must go into that that would be mind-boggling for us. But then there's this mental aspect about what you said about in the trials, how you had to stay focused and overcome some anxiety. Now you're waiting this time between your event and opening ceremony and keeping the balance of not just focusing totally on it. What about like your diet? I think we'd be interested. What is that like? Like, is your diet different when you're training for an event or you're right at an event than it is right now?
Yeah, so right now, I'm off, so I could eat whatever I want. But, you know, in season and when I'm competing that way, I'm eating a lot of lean foods that aren't going to, you know, be heavy in my stomach. And I eat more frequently throughout the day. I don't eat, you know, three giant meals or anything like that. Just I eat small portion sizes and more throughout the day. Mm-hmm. And it's much different because whereas I eat now, I can eat a bunch and it can just sit there and I don't have to worry about it because I'm not going to go jump. But in the competition days, you want to make sure that you're light, so you eat a lot of lighter foods.
In the Olympic, in the athlete's village, does it help? I mean, do they help with the diet or is it a distraction?
It's probably more of a distraction, if anything. So the dining area, dining hall is what they called it, is about the size of two football fields. I mean, it was huge. I mean, just enormous. And in the very back, you have a McDonald's, a huge
McDonald's. In the athlete's village.
Yes, and I don't know why they would do that, but it's an Olympic sponsor, so of course they would have a McDonald's in the background. And it was big. I mean, it might as well have been its own, you know, restaurant inside the dining hall. And but what was really neat about the dining hall area was that they brought in chefs from all the different countries to prepare their cuisine and offer it to all of the athletes. So they had the British cuisine where you could get, you know, fish and chips and whatever it is you wanted, and you could have the American cuisine, you had the Caribbean cuisine, you had the Asian cuisine, and you had, you know, lots of anything in between. And so you had an array of all this food, and it's open 24 hours, and you can get as much as you want whenever you want. And so it could have been a distraction. Whereas
I would think it could have been, but you stay focused.
Yes, you stay focused. You do what you've done up until that point. You don't go outside of that. You know, if I haven't eaten, you know, whatever it is, fish and chips, I shouldn't probably eat fish and chips while I'm there, even though it looked really good.
Sure. Stay focused, stay disciplined, all of that. Mm-hmm. So then you come to the night of the preliminaries, you know, right? Mm-hmm. What are you feeling? This is your event 10 days later. It's not going for the medal yet, is it?
Remarkably, I felt calm because I had prepared all year and for the last 4 years for that moment. And really, I wasn't, you know, I wanted to get to the final competition. Uh-huh. And so I went there to get my job done, to execute what I had been doing all year. And that's exactly what I did. I got out there and took one jump, which you normally get three jumps, you know, to either make top 12 in order to move on to finals or to get the A standard, which is which will automatically get you to the finals. And I took one jump and I got the job done. I didn't feel pressured. I didn't feel relieved. I just felt like I did my job.
You did your job that day, one jump, and you're ready for the next day. Mm-hmm. And we were all here. We were up in the chapel, many of us. Who came together and we watched it live. CNBC, one of the NBC stations, we were able to get online and we were cheering. And then we went, we're all coming back the next day, in which we did. We came back the next day. Mm-hmm. So you qualify, you're ready to go for the medal competition. Do you sleep that night? You go back to the athlete's village?
Yeah, so the first thing I did when I went back to the athlete village was take care of myself, and that was I had to sit in the ice tub, and that's not fun always. And then I had to, you know, get a massage to flush out the muscles and any type of, you know, buildup that I've gotten in the legs, and just kind of flush my body out and relax it. And then I went to bed and laid there for about 2 hours before I actually went to sleep.
Sure, sure. In that routine that you go through after you do your event, I'll bet we have no idea what it takes to, you know, sprint down, you know, the runway, whatever, make that jump. I mean, what is involved in all of that? To where you make one jump, you go, I gotta sit in the ice and all of that.
I mean, you're going down there and you're trying to jump as far as you can, which requires you to use 110% of your body. Wow. So, I mean, you're giving all you have. You're not going in there and say, oh, I'm going to give it 50% so I have some for tomorrow. You know,
No. Not
at all. You go in and you're going full blast, you know, 110%. And it takes a toll on your body, you know, so you want to take care of it as soon as you're done with your event, you want to get the ice bath to help your body recover a little bit faster.
Yeah.
And, you know, competing, you know, back-to-back days the way most of the athletes were and I was in my event, you have to just make sure that you take care of yourself, because I don't want to get in bed and then I didn't stretch and then I wake up the next day not feeling very good. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you take care of all that before you go to bed.
What kind of injuries have you had over the years as a professional athlete?
Countless injuries.
Really?
But mostly for me, I've had an ongoing battle with shin problems. So last year, I was out for about 2 months in the outdoor season because I had 4 stress fractures in my shin.
Stress fractures.
I had 3 in my tibia and 1 in my fibula. And wow. And it's my jump leg, so I plant on that leg, and every time I go down, it'd just be excruciating pain. And I hamstrings and hip flexors and IT band, and you just so many injuries that come, and you just have to manage those injuries as best you can, because a lot of the athletes that you compete against, they're injured as well, and they're just jumping or running or throwing regardless of those because they want to be the best. But in order to do that, you have to push your body to its absolute limits, which oftentimes causes injuries.
Sure. So I bet there's injuries that that you can't tell. As we look at the clip, we can't see there's any injury at all, but you're mm-hmm. dealing with it all the time. Mm-hmm. So you get to medal day. You come into the stadium. What's going through your head?
I'm a little bit more nervous than the day before.
Really? Yeah.
I'm feeling the pressure, and I'm feeling, I went there to get the job done, but I'm still feeling like, okay, this is the day. This is what it all boils down to. And but I was ready. I was very much ready. I felt pretty good, and I just trusted that I had what it took to get the gold medal.
Yeah. Well, and I would think, you have such an upbeat, exuberant personality and such an amazing smile, but you had to be on edge. Even though you didn't feel that in Eugene, Oregon at the trials, you had to have felt the pressure of that moment. And then what the announcer said was that your head dropped.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you made that jump, and talk about that, if you don't mind.
He was right. I don't know if you guys saw in the video, your trajectory, it matters. So if you're standing up and you lean forward and you bend your shoulders forward, mm-hmm. I mean, what's the thing that's gonna happen? You're gonna fall forward. And that's exactly what I did, whereas the correct technique is to keep your shoulders nice and upright and keep your chin up and level, so mm-hmm. that way you can carry your distance a little bit more. Mm-hmm. But I basically just cut off some distance in my event because I jumped and I leaned mm-hmm. forward and my feet dropped. So I cut off that little bit of distance that I could have held on to that jump. And I ended up jumping 689, and it was all I had for that day, and it wasn't even the best jump day I've ever had. It was one of the worst.
It was one of the worst. Mm-hmm. And the announcer said there was the one jump where, is it called, you faulted?
I fouled, yeah.
Fouled.
Yeah.
You fouled, and the announcer said, that's a gold, that was 23 feet. Yeah. That's a gold medal jump.
Yeah, I work so hard on my runway, which is what we call it, an approach, and it's you get on the runway, you run as fast as you can, you get to the board on your mark, and you jump. And usually if all those things goes well, you see the white flag and you get, yay, you have a good jump. Well, I went down the runway and I felt I had one of the best jumps I'd had all year. Wow. And I landed in the pit and I thought to myself, that was the jump. But when I turned around and I saw the official hold up the red flag, I felt crushed. Wow. And I felt that way, and my coach felt this way too, was because it was one of the best jumps I'd ever had. Mm. And it was a foul, and I thought it was a gold medal jump. And so I felt that after I fouled that one, I was chasing that jump again. I was looking to jump that far again, and it just wasn't there. And I was just devastated.
Mm-hmm. You know, I got this from your blog. You wrote this that night after the after that competition, after you won the bronze, you wrote, I left the athlete's village with one thing in mind, a gold medal. I began the competition with God at my side, calling on him with every jump I took. My plan, my goal was to be the best in the world on the Olympic year, and God's plan was for me to be a bronze medalist instead. How did you reconcile that, or How did you really feel when you were going around the track then with the flag and knowing that you won the bronze?
Well, you know, everyone always asks, you had to have been so ecstatic about your bronze medal. But because of that one foul that I felt was a gold medal jump, I was actually very unhappy. Huh. I was very unhappy because I trained so hard for a gold medal. You know, I didn't train for a bronze medal. So at that moment, when I was happy that I got onto the podium, mm-hmm. and that it was by, you know, thank God, a centimeter. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I was a little bit crushed, feeling like I didn't give it, you know, I just didn't have it. And I wanted that so bad. And so I was disappointed for a few days, feeling like, oh, if I woulda, coulda, shoulda, you know, mm-hmm. all those things I could have done, you know, knowing I couldn't change the outcome. But it wasn't until a few days later, I was with my family and my coach, and we were watching the high jump competition. And there was this girl, she's a women's high jumper, her name was Shantae Lowe, and she had been dominating the entire year in all of her events. So she had won every high jump competition that she had been in for the year. And we could have bet $1 million that this girl would have won a gold medal. And she was in fourth place, and she was going down on her third attempt, and you only get three attempts to make a height, to get over a height. And she goes down and she jumps and she knocks the bar down. And I watched her crumble to the mat and cry, and I saw the despair and the hurt and the pain that she was going through. And I think it was at that moment where I looked at my coach and we made eye contact and we went, thank God that we have a medal. Mm. And my perspective changed, because where I was mad at first, like I didn't train for this bronze medal, to thank God I have a gold medal. I was blessed enough to have a centimeter more to be the bronze medalist, and I was happy then.
And that's a gift that'll stay with yes. you. Hard work, mm-hmm. and a gift that'll stay with you your entire life. Mm-hmm. What's it mean to be an Olympian?
You know, it means hard work and mm-hmm. dedication, but it also means that I am an Olympian, but it's not all of who I am. A lot of people don't realize that I just finished my master's degree this year in occupational therapy. Oh. And I'm gonna be an occupational therapist, and I plan on being one of the best occupational therapists in Northern Colorado, and it's a part of who I am. Whereas I'm also an Olympian, it just doesn't define who I am. It's not everything.
It's not everything.
It's not everything, but I'm a follower of Christ. I'm an occupational therapist, and I'm an Olympian.
Very good, very good. Do you set goals for yourself like that? What do you do when you set a goal, occupational therapy, master's degree, or be in the Olympics? I mean, you write it on a mirror, and you wake up first thing you see every morning?
I personally don't write it on a mirror, just because I'll always know what my goal is. Okay. But I do tell my husband Patrick or someone what my goal is, because then I feel like you can be held accountable for that goal in which you're trying to achieve. So for example, if I'm gonna start my diet or start eating better, I tell Patrick that I'm gonna start eating better, so that when I go to the closet and reach for that piece of chocolate, you know, he can slap my hand away from the food. Whereas if I don't tell him, you know, that I'm gonna go on a diet and I'm gonna start eating better, I can go to the closet and pick seven sure. chocolates, and he, you know, well, you're eating chocolate. Oh, well, you know, go ahead. So I feel like to tell someone what your goal is, why you want to achieve it, you know, all of the intricacies about that goal, you can be held accountable for it. Not only do you know it, but someone else knows it and can help you get to that goal.
That's key. I think it's really key. You know, you think about that Old Testament verse in Ecclesiastes, two are better than one. It says if they fall down, they have someone to help them up. Three's even better. I mean, there's something that happens in community when we share our life with somebody else instead of keeping things a secret. And even in goal setting, I never heard of anyone talk about it in terms of goal setting. Mm-hmm. But I think that's very key, to tell someone. That's a takeaway that I think we all can have from this. You know, what's some of the biggest challenges that you're facing right now after the Olympics and your career and your life?
Some of the biggest challenges are, one, just staying healthy, mm-hmm. You know, getting back into track and field. You know, it's just a process of, you know, are my legs okay? Do I feel okay? Am I getting enough nutrients? Am I, you know, getting enough sleep? So it's a 24-hour process.
24-hour process. 24 it's hours. Not done. What does the medal mean to you?
It means a lot of hard work, and it means that I tried my best. I did everything that I could. All the dedication and hard work, it means that it paid off. Mm-hmm. All it that hard off. Work paid off.
Yeah. Set goals, don't give up. Mm-hmm. And you tried to be in the Olympics before. Tell us a little bit about that experience.
I did. In 2008, when I was a senior in college, I qualified for the Olympic trials. It was in Eugene, Oregon, just like it was this past year. And I went out there thinking I was going to do well, and I ended up getting 21st out of 25. And I learned a lesson. I learned a really big lesson there. And it was either you could, you know, crawl away with your tail between your legs and give up, or it was continue on, fight on, work hard, and make a difference and do something to try and redeem. For me, it was, I got to redeem myself.
It's good. I mean, the idea of setting goals, working hard, then come in 21st out of 25 and not give up. Not just say, I mean, that's an honor to go to those finals then. Yeah. But to not give up and to keep going and to end up with the bronze medal in 2012. That's pretty outstanding.
Yeah.
What's the best advice you would give to young people that are here, that are athletes or pursuing whatever their dream is, whether it's, you know, in music, teaching, medicine, or not just young people, all of us here? What would you say? Best advice you would give us?
Because of, you know, my personal experience and the 2008 Olympics and not making it, it would be never give up. Because had I given up, you know, 4 years ago, I wouldn't even be close to being where I am today. And I think it's important that we all remember that sometimes it's not going to be easy. Sometimes it's going to be really difficult. And sometimes it's going to be at that point where you feel like it's not going to happen for me. You know, that's when you have to, you know, take into consideration that you're doing hard work. It will pay off. So that's my advice, is never, ever give up.
Never give up. Keep working hard.
Keep working and believe, and believe that you can do it, and believe that, you know, if you ask for it, it will be given it to you.
What's the best advice a coach or someone gave you?
My coach, one day, I guess it was a few years ago, we were doing a workout that I just didn't think I could do. It was a really difficult workout, and I was already hurting, and I was in the middle of it, and I was getting ready to quit. And he goes to me, "What's your goal?" And I said, "It's to get a gold medal." And he said, "Do you really want a gold medal?" I'm like, "Yes, I really want a gold medal." And this is where his advice comes in. And he looks at me, and he shakes his head, and he said, "Then suck it up."
Suck it up. Suck it up. Yeah. And so what did you do when you heard that? Were you taken back?
I was a little bit. I was kind of like, oh, okay. But I did. I sucked it up. I got through the workout, and 3 weeks later, in that same workout, I basically beat my own times, and I had like a record for myself that I had beaten. I didn't think I could do it. I mean, 2 weeks prior to that, I didn't think I could finish the workout, to where I got to the point where I could finish the workout in record time.
You found out you could push on further, do more.
And a lot of times, athletes and people, you know, fall short of accomplishing something because it's at that point where it feels like it's too much and it's too hard. And all they have to do is try. Try a little bit harder, and especially physically. Mentally, you feel like, oh, I can't do it, but your body probably can do it.
Your body can do it. So much is mental, isn't it? Like Paul says in Romans, be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Or in Proverbs, there's a proverb in Proverbs 23 that says, as a person thinks, as a man or a woman thinks, so he or she is. Mm-hmm. Our bodies can do it, but the battle is so much in our head. Mm-hmm. So you get the you win the bronze, and you finish your professional long jumper. You don't just come home and it's all done. No, you go on to other places.
Yeah, for me and most of the other track and field athletes, the season isn't over. The season doesn't end till middle of September or end of September. And I had four post-Olympic competitions. I went to Stockholm, I went to Budapest, I went to Zurich, and Lausanne, which was in Switzerland. So I had those competitions to get ready for and be prepared for. And didn't matter if you were a gold medalist, a silver medalist, or a bronze medalist, you were going there to win, essentially, or they were coming there to beat you.
Sure, it just keeps going then, keeps going. Then you come home for another big event, though, that you have. What was that?
I got married.
Got married. Yes, Patrick is here. Very good. And how did you guys meet?
He was a high jumper at CSU. He was a freshman. I was a senior. We were friends. We were really good friends. And he had an injury, and I, you know, nursed him back to health. But really, I was just his friend. And
sure. That's good,
so,
though,
yeah.
Huh?
But, you know, we good friends, best friends to married couple.
Very good. What's in store for Janay Deloach in 4 or 5 years from now?
In 5 years, I plan on being, like I said early, one of the best occupational therapists in Northern Colorado has ever seen.
Good.
And but, you know, go back a year, in 4 years, I hope that if I can stay healthy and I can stay competitive, that I can go for the 2016 Rio Olympics.
Very good. Very good. You know, I think if you make that, I think you need like a pastor that would come with you. Just pray for you before every time.
They have phones now.
Oh. That's so did you have fun in London?
I did. I had a blast.
Yeah. Did you meet LeBron or, you know,
yeah, I
Carmelo
met,
Anthony?
I did. I have a picture with Carmelo Anthony. I met LeBron James and all of the basketball players. They're a good lot of guys. Yeah,
sure.
They were fun to meet with and hang out with.
And what about, like, do you know anything about Michael Phelps that, like, you could share with us? That nobody will say anything. You know, but, like, just...
Well, you know, on TV, he looks like he's extremely tall. Like, he looks really tall. At least to me, he does. But in person, and I met him in the elevator, he's actually a little bit shorter than I anticipated. So I was expecting to see this really tall guy, and I was like, oh, you're just average.
It's not that tall.
Yeah.
Everybody looks tall to me. You know, but I would have thought he was way tall, too, but he's not. No.
And on the other token, I met some of the gymnasts. And when I saw them, they look huge on TV. They look really tall and big. And then when I saw them, I was like, wow, they're bite-sized. They're really small.
In the off-season, they're bite-sized, yeah. What's like a closing comment that you would make for all of us, or just what God has laid on your heart through this whole experience as an Olympian, as a professional athlete, as a newly married young woman?
You know, God has a plan for us, each and every one of us. And, you know, although we wish to guide our own lives, and I wish to have had a gold medal, but he gave me a bronze, just know that he has a plan for you. And whether it be something you don't necessarily want, it's because it's necessary. And so just go with it and pray that he'll guide you. And he'll always give you enough to do what you need.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thanks, Janay. Let's thank Janay. I'm going to pray for you. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for Janay. Thank you for her gifts, her abilities, the talent that you've given her. Thank you for the dreams that you've placed in her heart and her mind, and that she's pursued them. And God, how it must make you smile when you see one of your children strive to be the very best with what you've given them. God, continue to guide her life now that the games are over, as her career continues in professional athletics for now. God, we know that athletics is very much a game, but we know also that through the Olympic Games and her career as an athlete, she's been an inspiration and such a positive example to all of us here and to people throughout our country in the world. And God, I ask you to bless her life, bless her career, bless her marriage, and bless her future. And I thank you for Janay sharing her story with us. And God, thank you most of all that her faith is in you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thanks, Janay. You know, I just got, give me like 2 minutes right here before we go. I just want to say, stay standing too. This is just for a moment here. Isn't it an inspiration to see someone follow their God-given talents, developing them, follow that calling, that God-given calling on their life? And you know what? I believe we all have a calling, all of us. Some people think that a calling is for a special category of people. You know, that's for professional pastors, missionaries, a Mother Teresa, doctor in Ethiopia or something. But we couldn't be further from the truth on that. I believe that God has given each of us a calling. And it doesn't matter if you work in a church, the marketplace, you're an athlete, you're a teacher, you work at a construction site behind a desk. God has given us talents and abilities that we couldn't fully develop in 100 lifetimes. And God wants us to develop those abilities. God wants us to raise the ceiling that we tend to impose on our own potential. That's what God wants us to do. And don't you love stories? Like Janay comes in 21st out of 25 in 2008 going for the Olympics. How many people would have given up at that point? But instead she goes, no, my goal's the going to the Olympics. And she does it. I mean, you hear stories like the Beatles, you know, turned down for a record contract by Decca Records. They said groups with guitars will never make it. That was in the 60s. What about Michael Jordan? Cut from the basketball team when he's 15 years old in high school. Walt Disney, fired from his first job at a newspaper. They said, you're not creative enough. You don't have enough new ideas. But they don't give up. They keep going. That's what God wants for all of us. God's given us gifts, talents, and abilities. And I know some people go, oh, that's not me. I don't have those kind of gifts, talents, and abilities. Other people do. Other people are superstars. Not me. I'm a Hugo. Other people are superstars. Other people got talent and ability. I got passed over. I can almost hear God in thunderous tones say, watch out when you say that. Don't say things like that, that you don't have talent and ability. He's saying, God says, I've created you in my image. Created you in my image. You got skills 100,000 iPads could not match. You've got gifts, talents, and abilities waiting to be developed. You're the crown of my creation. The New Testament, it says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has in store for those who love him. But that means we're going to have to take some chances. We're going to have to push, not give up easily. Set goals, not give up. It means we're going to have to maybe take a class, stretch us intellectually. Take music lessons, art lessons. Hire a coach that we can train under to be the best athlete that we could be. We got to raise the level on that ceiling that we tend to impose on our own potential. And I believe there's three kinds of people in the world. Those that make things happen, those who watch things happening, and those that don't even know what's happening. I think Crossroads Church is full of people that want to make things happen. And I look out every week, I see a storehouse of power and potential. People that are athletic, artistic, musical, good working with their hands, good working with kids, good working with the elderly. People with winning personalities, just waiting to be developed. And when we develop those things, we become an inspiration for others. And God uses us to make a difference in people's lives like Janay has done. Let's thank Janay one more time. Thank you. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you. Dennis is gonna take Janay right now into the atrium. Dennis is gonna take Janay there. She has some pictures. You can get in line, get an autograph. The line will be big, and so you can't.